How does student life in USA really feel like, and how do you prepare for the entire process, right from applying for the university, getting your I-20, getting your visa, and finally landing in the US? Today's video is a really fun chat with Ravi Raj, who's going to be explaining everything that he did, and he's particularly talking about funding and how he prepared his funding since his parents were not his main sponsors. So let's get started and keep on watching. Hi guys, my name is Shachi and I'm a travel and a visa coach. On this channel, you will find lots of useful videos on the US visa process, especially the F1 process. I have a whole new playlist for Spring 22. So make sure that you subscribe to the channel and check out all these videos. So today's video is going to be a fun chat with Ravi Raj, and he's spilling the beans on everything that he did to finally land in the US. Now, before we get into his experience, here's a quick snapshot of Ravi Raj's profile. Education, so he's done engineering and computer science. Work experience, he's worked as a data analyst for 2 years with Cerner, which is a healthcare company. His admit is from University of Texas, Dallas, and his funding was through a loan and his uncle being his sponsor. So if you too want to prepare for your F1 visa interview with me, just like Ravi Raj did, then feel free to get in touch. You can either book a one-to-one consultation session or you can take a mock interview. The link for both of these is in the description box below. And now let's jump into the conversation with Ravi Raj.
Hello.
Hey,
Shachi.
How are you?
Good to see you again.
Yeah.
So I wanted to talk to you to, basically understand the entire preparation process. Right? Mm-hmm. I have a few questions. Mm-hmm. And also, now that you're already there, to also ask you a few questions about how your experience there has been so far.
So my name is Ravi and I'm from Bangalore. And I did all of my education in Bangalore and I graduated from Sarem Visheshwara Institute of Tech in computer science. And I graduated with an 8.3 GPA. Then I have 2 years of work experience in Cerner, which is a healthcare MNC, and I worked there for 2 years as a data analyst. So that's where I come from. The course that I joined is MSCS in UT Dallas.
So starting with the interview prep, right, the visa interview prep. So what was your thought process going into it? How many days or months before did you actually start planning for it? And
so the planning for it went on for almost like 45 days before the interview, where it began with the rush of, them opening up the slots and, mm-hmm. all of us applying on the same day.
Yeah.
After that, I think slowly everything started falling into place. But once I got into that a couple of weeks in and I'm like, very skeptical about stuff, and I'm pretty sure you know what was going on in my mind, because I think we met like 3 weeks before my interview and then 1 week before my interview, right?
So correct, yeah.
It's like there's uncertainty, there's a ton of questions about what to carry, what not to carry, what to say, what not to say. And you start reading reviews of other people and how their interviews went, and then people are like, I got a reject, I got an admit, and you don't know why they got a reject, right? So yeah. I think that paranoia kind of takes over you. Like, the closer you are to the date, the higher the paranoia, irrespective of the number of documents you have ready, because you never know who's the kind of person who's going to grill you, right? So
correct, yeah.
Yeah, getting the finances together, getting the financial documentation, and then getting the copies of my, at a point of time, even getting Xerox copies of my own academic documents felt like a chore, right? So that's probably the nerves that we're talking, but yeah.
So we did, I think, mock sessions, right, before the interview. So how did that help in the entire journey of, just feeling confident?
I'll be honest. I'll be honest with you. Like, technically, you kind of calmed down the nerves that were, like, on the verge of breaking. So, our discussions were more or less along the lines of the finances, most of it, because that's my weak spot and I didn't really know how to take care of it. But the answers which we prepared on, I think, that sort of gave me a little bit of a confidence ki chalo clear ho jayega interview. So I think it's a lot more about how you handled it than what you did, and I think that kind of helped me, kind of know that actually did help me a lot, right? So it's I think it's all about those calming nerves. Like somebody needs to be there who knows what's going to happen and tell you, like, listen, calm down. Right. And I think that's exactly what you did. And that's kind of, I low-key owe my visa to you.
No. So anyway, coming to funding, that was my next question for you, right? So for you, the funding was not by a parent. Okay. And this is something which freaks out a lot of people. You know, when the parent is not the main sponsor, they are really scared that I'm not going to get my visa, which is not the case, which we've seen repeatedly and also for you. So from a funding perspective, what would you like to tell people who are in a similar boat? You know, parent is not funding, but you have the legit, you know, the documents, everything prepared. So how to handle this? Just to set the context for you, funding was your uncle, right?
Your
immediate uncle, right?
Yes, yes. An immediate uncle, right? And it could be your... So from what I understand is, as long as you're able to show somebody who's paying their taxes regularly and who, you know, has a steady enough source of income, I think you should not have a problem. Once I had all the documentation ready, I didn't really have to worry more about it, because at the end of the day, family is still family, right? So that's the thing. They did ask
me
about
the funding. So did she ask you why not parent?
She didn't ask me why not parent, but she did ask me what my uncle did and how much he made a year, right? So okay. I think that is something that you need to be very clear on. You can't go out there and say, I think he makes so much. That's not valid. And if you are asking somebody to be your sponsor, you need to have their details clear, right? You can't have fudge numbers and be like, you know, I think he makes around so much a year. He also has so many other sources of income. They don't really care about it, right? You just give them a number, and can you substantiate that number with some hardcore proof? So as long as it is some family member, it should be that person is an immediate relative and should be able to sign an affidavit saying, itna dunga main.
And have the resources.
Yeah, I have the resources for it. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But these are my resources that I've attached, and this is my guarantee that I will fund it.
I'll fund, correct, yes. So that's like very clearly put. This is what I try to explain to so many students, that there is a way to do it the correct way, right? Now the next 2 months, a lot more people are appearing for the interview, you know, for the winter intake. Mm-hmm. So what preparation advice would you give them
with respect to the visa interviews? I think one thing is to be very clear on why you're doing your course, right? Especially when you're a spring admit, they will ask you why you didn't go in fall, or why you didn't apply for a fall either, right?
Or why you deferred if they have.
But if you directly applied to spring, then you will face a question key. Why spring? Why not fall? Right? And that is something you need to have a clear answer on, at least in my
opinion. Any inputs from your end for this?
So you've got to be like, a lot of people, the reason why they take up spring admit is because they did not get the fall admit. Right? I'll be honest. But that's not necessarily the case. And that's not something they will like to hear as well. Because to them, you're somebody who couldn't make it in one go, so you're trying the second time, right? So, I mean, the most tactful way to apply to it is, because I wanted to make sure I had everything ready and get confidence in my ability to pull through with this course. And once that was done is when I chose to apply, and hence the spring admit. So you need to make it seem more like your decision actively. It shouldn't be like circumstantial, or, you know,
I'm trying to get in.
It should seem like spring is your obvious choice. Or else it could even be simple things like, you know, I had a healthcare procedure to be done, or like, you know, I had some work at home which I needed to complete before I even applied, or before I was sure of applying. Don't tell them ki funding arrange nahi hua, because again then they'll start grilling you on the funding. Just make it seem more of an academic and a long-term plan perspective thing about how you thought your life through, and that's why you're going now for spring. That's primarily what you would have to do.
Great, that helps. All right, so now that we've got the visa interview part done, so about your experience of 1.5 months there, right? So I have a little expectation versus reality scenario for you. So I'm going to tell you what it is, and you tell me what you expected and what the reality is, right? So first, starting with the course.
The course, whatever your expectation is, it will be better than that.
Okay,
irrespective
great.
Of who that is, because in India in specific, we are used to a certain set of a curriculum or a certain style of teaching, right? Which is not going to be the case here. They will not teach you like that. They won't schedule you like that. And for all I know and care, half the time the professor won't even tell you what to do. He'll just assume you know some basics and he will pick up from that, right? So it will need a lot of additional effort from you outside, which is why master's year is no joke, right? Like you come and a lot of people have this complaint. My friend went to the US and then lost contact with me. And I can personally vouch it's not because your friend doesn't want to talk to you. They cannot.
He has no time.
They have a ton of things to do. Exactly, right? So, and the coursework will exceed your expectations. Like, you know, you will expect to learn some stuff and you will learn. And you will learn more than just that.
Okay, that's great. Yeah. Okay. Second one is expenses.
The first 1 month, be prepared to spend twice your estimate, whatever your estimate.
Okay.
Like, if you thought in a month you would spend $800.
You mean like on everything, even on rent, utilities, or do you mean like the most setting up costs?
Let's say, yeah, the setting up costs are high, irrespective of whether you take a furnished house or a unfurnished house. The setup costs will take you a while because you might be able to get, like, you know, every college kind of has this thing where they give away free furniture and stuff like that, or the people moving out kind of give away their stuff.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Without really, yeah, but without realizing, you have a lot of expenses that come your way, right? And you probably you might have experience living alone in a hostel or something like that, or in a PG or somewhere where you cooked alone. But coming to a new country, you take a while to get used to the options available to you and to be able to make use of them, right? So,
and also I think to make sense of spending in dollar, right?
Yeah.
Getting
that
used
is something
to that,
that you need to actively pursue to not do the translation from rupee to dollar or dollar to rupee and vice versa. Unless you are sending money back home or getting money from home, right? Like, except in that instance, I think you should not be doing the translation, because then, like, for example, let's just talk about milk, right? At our place, we look at what milk for 25 bucks for half liter or 50 rupees a liter, right? Whereas here you're looking at almost 75 to 80 rupees a liter, right? And that's still okay. But then you look at stuff like onions, right? Where you're going at 75 bucks a kg. You're going at 75 bucks a pound, not even a kg, right? So when you do the translation, you're looking at like almost 200 rupees ke onion kha rahe hain.
It's like your mother back home would get a heart attack, right?
Yeah, if you told your mom, she would genuinely judge you, right? So that's the thing. It's stuff like that. So you cannot afford to do the translations.
But overall, the expenses are going to be more than what you're expecting it to be. So
only in the first month. Only in the
first month. Okay.
After, and in the first month, you're in a new country. So you want to experience stuff. So you land up traveling a lot.
Yes.
More.
You want to explore
more. You're on the tourist vibe. So a lot goes into your cabs and it goes into, like, you know, shopping for stuff, souvenirs, this, that, college hoodies.
Oh, you're already buying souvenirs.
No, I mean, you visited there, that's your first
trip. Achha, like that, okay.
Right, this is the first restaurant I went to, so thoda zyada tip denge. The first month will be a little hard on your pocket, but from the second month, once you've gauged how expensive things are and once you've planned out, like, how much you need for cooking for a week, or, you know, you would have figured that out in the first month. And then once you start optimizing, whatever math you did, you're looking at a plus minus $50, which is, I think, acceptable.
Okay, that's good. Okay. And the third thing I have to ask you is the campus and the accommodation, right? I mean, they're two different things. So first, let's talk about the campus vibe, the environment. What sort of life did you imagine you would have, and what is it in reality?
The vibe that you get from shows, Netflix,
is it like
shows
that?
About how universities look, it is exactly like that.
The that's great. Yeah.
That chill life belongs only to the undergrad, not to the master's. So you will see all these events happen. Like, you will genuinely see all these events happen, but you won't be a part of it because you're running to study. You are shifting classes or you're going to your...
So you're there, class. But not there. It's,
So you get to participate in a lot of stuff too. I won't deny that. So the campus is great. Like, you will see a lot more than what you've bargained for, and the labs are huge, and then the classrooms are huge, and not many institutions boast of such populations as UTD, because UTD takes in a lot of people. But I mean, depending on the college size and the batch size, I think you will be actively involved in a lot of stuff. And I haven't heard of any university being very miniature and small. They're all huge ones, and they involve a lot of walking. So be prepared for that. But yeah.
Okay. Okay. Great. So accommodation is something which worries a lot of people. I'm not sure why, because on the face of it, it would seem like it would be pretty straightforward, right? So where are you staying? Are you staying on campus, or what's your accommodation?
No, I'm staying off campus.
Off campus. Okay. So,
So
how does one prepare?
It terrifies us. Yeah. Very specific. The reason, unless you are coming with friends, you don't know the kind of people you will be living with, right? And that's a big surprise, right? Now, I think pretty much a lot of people already undergo this when they begin their undergraduation in different cities into hostels. But the difference is, here you don't have hostels. So there is nobody cooking for you, right? Nobody is cleaning up after you. You are the one who's doing the cooking and the cleaning, right? So that kind of terrifies people. And then another thing that comes into the picture is the necessity that you need to, you know, optimize your travel time, right? Now, there are many of us have classes that like one of my roommate has a class from 7:30 in the evening to 10 in the night, right? Because that's when the professor's there. So it depends, and accordingly. So if it's 10 in the night, you need to figure out a way of coming back to your house, and then you need to look at the safety issues, because it's not that there is a ton of crime here, but you are never immune to crime either, right?
Correct.
You never know what can happen.
Yes.
So you need to pick a safe neighborhood which does not have a history of violence. So you've got to you need to look up the crime rates in the city and look for places which are affordable as well as not so bad for living, right? So that you need to figure out. So I think your biggest and the most important concern for you is safety of the place. Second thing is proximity to resources, right? Now, you can't afford to travel to a Walmart that's 40 miles away or 30 miles away. You need a Walmart in 3 to 2 miles, so that if need be, you can walk the distance, right? You shouldn't have to depend on additional this thing, like transportation routes, right? So you need to check your connectivity to the campus. That's another thing. What are the bus routes available? Which bus or which tube should you take to get to that place, right? So I think second thing should be utilities that you prioritize. How far away it is from campus and how far away is it from other resources. And then finally comes the third part, the affordability as well. Because you can't afford to spend like $800 only on the rent. Right? Depending on the city/state that you're in. Now, $800 for rent for two people, for one person, $600 for rent in California seems reasonable. But $600 for rent in like a Texas, you're being looted, or you're being unreasonably luxurious, right? So you've got to do your math in that case about accommodation.
Any specific resource or a website where such accommodation, or is it just random Facebook groups and networks?
You have to figure out via Facebook groups.
Okay.
At least that's what I did. So I assume that's how everybody gets them done. Facebook groups.
And you had your accommodation booked before you reached, or did you go there and you had it?
Don't do the mistake of trying to come here and figuring things out, because hotels are retard expensive. Land up spending $50 a day on an average. And if you are in a hotel, you can't do cooking and shit also. So your food also needs to be from outside. So expenses just snowball very quickly. So unless it's absolutely unavoidable, get yourself an apartment before you come here. But also, depending on how sure you are of the apartment, because sometimes people just give you pictures. They don't really show you real-time stuff, right? When they give you pictures, the pictures could be old. You could be scammed through, right? So you need to also validate the legitimacy of your resources. Don't just take up some sketchy deal that you found like on Craigslist and shit, right? So you've got to be smarter than that, and you've got to figure out what is good, what appears to be good, and what are the amenities that these guys actually provide and whether they are completely legit or not. But yeah, it would be a lot more sensible to book before coming here, because if you want to come here and book, by then a lot of the good apartments would already be taken. You'll be left with the bad ones or the relatively not so good ones, right? And that, I mean, you've got to live there and you don't really have your parents to take care of you, right?
Yeah.
So you've got to get back to the place and set it up by yourself still. And it can be a little straining, both physically and emotionally. So it's good to, you know, have a plan and then come here.
Okay, great. Any last minute checklist for spring 2022, people? Especially coming to UTD.
If you're coming to UTD, please make sure at least to carry two sweater sort of things, because it will get really cold, and at that time the problem is here it rains at that time too, right? So you need your waterproof stuff. Carry an umbrella, mandatory, whether you come here and immediately buy or from India, but an umbrella is mandatory, a couple of sweaters are mandatory. Get yourself a good pair of boots. And I think the rest of it will be sorted. You can, at least with respect to UTD, like there's Indian stores here, so even if you forgot like a pressure cooker, you could buy one.
Yeah, it's okay.
Not a problem. But yeah, it will be a little more expensive. So anything steel related, please get it from India, because
bartan matlab khud ke leke aana India se.
Like kapde, at least you can get them in a sale and you won't feel really bad about spending like 10 bucks.
Yeah, I think especially the heavy duty winter wear will be much more affordable there, right? Than in India.
Yeah.
Whereas utensils and all these things will be cheaper back home. So.
Because the people here use a lot more of oven related stuff than
not the way we cook.
Yeah, and please get everything that's induction compatible. That's mandatory, because yahan pe koi gas stove use nahi karta. At least I haven't seen anybody. It's either coil based or induction based, right? So get everything that's non-stick. Get ladles, like silicone ladles.
All right, thank you so much. This is a really fun chat, and all the best. I hope you do really
Thank you. Bye. Take care. Bye-bye.
So I hope this fun chat with Aviraj has helped you and cleared out a lot of things. In case you want to speak to him, feel free to get in touch with him. He would be happy to help. His LinkedIn profile is mentioned in the description box below. And in case you want to work with me for your F1 visa interview, feel free to do that. You can either book a one-to-one consultation session. This is an in-depth session where we will structure the answers and prepare you for all possible interview questions. We'll also get the funding plan in place, check the documents and everything else that is there. So the link for booking the consultation session is in the description box. And one more thing that's really, really useful is a mock interview. So remember that F1 visa is an actual visa interview, right? So how you perform in the interview, your body language, your confidence, the structuring of your answers also play a very important role. And this is where a mock interview helps, because it gets you the feel of an actual visa interview. So this mock interview will be done by me on a one-to-one video call, and it's very, very similar to the actual visa interview. Tons of students have found it useful. So if you too want to take a mock interview with me, just like Raviraj did, again, the link for that is in the description box. Thank you so much for watching. I really hope that you stay tuned for all the videos that are coming up. Also, the next F1 workshop is now live. So if you want to be part of the next F1 workshop, the link for registering for the workshop is also in the description box. Before I end, I also want to tell you about the F1 prep course. So this is a video course which many people have used to prepare for their F1 visa interview. And it's a very compact, concise way consisting of 11 different video modules, sample answers and templates. And you can prepare for the interview at your own time and pace. So if you want to check out this course, do check the link in the description box. All right, so this is everything that I had to share with you in today's video. Stay tuned for a lot more useful videos coming up in the Spring 22 series. And signing off for now, I'll see you in the next one. Bye.